My name is Dr. David Kroska. I'm actually an OBGYN physician in St. Cloud, and my hobby is gardening. And heirloom tomatoes is one of my passions. I've been growing heirlooms for quite some years in an effort to try to find the perfect tomato, the gourmet flavor we've all been seeking for, the perfect tomato taste, to get away from that old supermarket tomato thing that we're sort of straddled with all winter long here in Minnesota. So in so doing, we've been growing lots of varieties for many years. And in so doing, along the way, we've actually had a lot of our friends, neighbors, family get tomato plants from us. And so as a result of that, we have begun to sell a little bit of tomatoes on the side, tomato transplants, pepper transplants, and eggplants, varieties you just can't find elsewhere on the market out there at large. To do so requires investment in time and effort, of course. To grow a good quality tomato transplant requires a greenhouse. It requires some effort as far as heating and lighting and fixtures and that sort of thing. Now, all home gardeners could possibly grow some of their own tomato plants. Many of you probably do. But it takes a bit more to get a quality plant. You find out the great growing them in the window and milk cartons, for example, has its limitations. They get long and tall, and it's called etiolated, and just aren't quite as robust when it comes down to transplanting them. So anyway, we get just one thing led to another. It's kind of one of those obsessive compulsive hobby things. And so growing the perfect transplant and growing the varieties of tomatoes that we have has led us to found what's called ACME Tomatoes. And so if any of you are interested in obtaining heirloom plants for your gardens, we have a booth downstairs and a catalog available. So heirloom tomatoes, what is an heirloom tomato? There are many books about the subject out there, some excellent quality ones. The one you see up here by Amy Goodman is one of the most recent introductions. Is a gorgeous book of photographs of heirlooms. An heirloom has to be three things to qualify as an heirloom. First of all, it has to be a variety that can self-reproduce. These are called open pollinated tomato varieties. Much of what you purchase by seed order catalogs and from nurseries are hybrid tomatoes. I'll talk about them here momentarily. So an open pollinated variety is one which by and large will be self-fertile. The historic wild tomatoes out there in the world are cross-pollinating, so they tend to produce new cultivars, new varieties in their offspring. But the kind that by reasons of chance mutations that we call heirlooms come from mutations that began quite a long time ago, where the tomatoes actually don't have a very long anther, so they don't fertilize themselves, or the style is short. The variety also must have been around for 50 years or better to qualify for heirloom status, and of course must have a history of its own, and many have colorful histories. You've heard terms like, for example, mortgage lifter tomato, or Zapotec, which is named after the tribal highland natives of central Mexico, Cherokee Purple, after the Cherokee Indians and such. They all have these colorful stories. Brandywine and Mennonite, and there's a whole host of colorful names that are attached to tomatoes that go back to ethnic groups or origins and are called heirlooms. Tomatoes, of course, a big thing in America. All folks who do raise gardens, the majority of people will raise a tomato plant or more for their own use. You cannot beat homegrown tomatoes in flavor. I mean, a vine-ripened tomato has got an unparalleled fragrance to it, a flavor to it, a sweetness to it that they just can't capture otherwise. Heirloom tomatoes are very diverse. There's many of them, of course. There are, in fact, over 4,000 in the Seed Savers Exchange catalog that one can obtain seed for through other members in the Seed Savers Exchange or through them. Many of those more well-known heirlooms can be bought through their Seed Saving Exchange catalog. Their flavor, of course, is the reason. Why would you grow an heirloom tomato? Why would the chefs of the finest restaurants, the gourmet restaurants in San Francisco and all throughout California and other parts of the country use heirlooms preferentially in their cooking or in their fresh tomato use? Very, very simply, they're incredibly good tasting. Hybrids, the good, the bad, and the ugly. Why did hybrids start? What are hybrids all about? The idea of having a hybrid tomato came about because of proprietary, that is, companies, wishing to develop varieties that they could sell and capture market for. It also, of course, tries to capture qualities in tomatoes that are good for commercial production. Qualities like, for example, thick skin, durability, not bruising, being able to be picked mechanically and harvested by machines and green ripened in ethylene gas. These are all things that add to the qualities that make a commercial tomato desirable. Taste, as I said here, is optional. It didn't always figure into the equation. And then somewhere in that equation, taste got lost. If you compare what you find in heirloom tomatoes, what you find with hybrids, there's quite a rainbow of flavors and tastes to be had out there. You cannot save seeds, of course, from hybrids. If you try to grow seed from a hybrid plant, say Big Boy is an example, you will not get Big Boy tomatoes from those seeds. You're going to get a couple of parent types. It's probably not even taste good at all. It just doesn't produce true to form. It's a cross from two parents. You have to cross those two parents again to get the same kind of product. And that's why they're proprietary. And that's why they try to sell you more of those in their catalogs, because you got to keep coming back every year to buy them. You can't just save your own seed to keep for an heirloom hybrids. There are some good hybrids. I don't want to say all are bad. There are some good hybrids. In fact, there are some wonderful hybrids that are just unique. One of them is called Sun Sugar in the fine print down here in the bottom. Sun Sugar is a hybrid that's made in Japan. It's a cherry tomato. They're orange colored. They happen to have about twice the beta carotene or vitamin A content of typical tomatoes and an incredibly high Brix rating, which is a sugar content. These tomatoes are sugary sweet. They're amazingly sweet. So as you raise a Sun Sugar tomato, once you raise one, you're hooked. In our business of ACME Tomato, it's the most coveted tomato plant. We get orders, some folks order 2, 3, 4 or a dozen and give them away to their friends, but they're amazing tomatoes as far as their flavor. Most don't make it to your kitchen because they get eaten between the garden and the kitchen, so they have a lot of very good things to commend them. Well, I think there's a bit more to the whole story. Could continue on the issue. Why would you want to save your own seed? Why would you want to propagate varieties that are not, quotes, modern? In point of fact, biodiversity, sustainability, and local production is, I think, an issue of importance to us all economically. When you consider how far your tomatoes are grown from us, the bulk of the kitchen tomatoes that we buy today, other than those that are greenhouse produced here locally, come from Florida. And Florida's kind of a year-round tomato producing state. They are the number one state for kitchen tomato production. Much to their discredit or credit, I don't know, the kind of tomatoes they produce there are not very flavorful. They're very durable, they're hard. There's books written about them. There's a book called Tomato Land, written by Barry Esterbrook. I'll come back to that in a few slides here. But in his book, he details the sordid business of slave labor and bad labor relations and the ugly side of growing tomatoes in Florida. It's a very bad place to grow tomatoes in terms of the sandy soil. It requires a lot of added fertilizers. It's a very humid location, and for that reason, tomatoes grown in Florida require huge amounts of pesticides and herbicides to get a crop. So a typical tomato you buy in Florida has 30 different potentially measurable pesticide residues in it. So not only getting a bulletproof, tasteless tomato, you're getting something that's relatively contaminated. So I think local production is good when you can do it. Biodiversity is a good idea, and I think heirloom tomatoes is all about biodiversity in its essence. What's an F1? That's a hybrid. Filial 1, the first generation offspring of a parent set of parents, is called an F1 hybrid. That's what you buy predominantly when you buy seeds in their commercial catalogs. But it's loss of diversity. If you go back to 1903, when pretty much all tomatoes were not hybrids, over 408 commercial varieties were available. And going fast forwarding to 1983, about an 81% loss of those varieties. And that's about the point when heirloom tomatoes enter the picture. And the Seed Savers Exchange in Decorah, Iowa, spearheaded an effort, if you will, to preserve and to find these old varieties that were being grown in, say, Pennsylvania and elsewhere, where people kept the seed from generation to generation. So from that point on, there's been a real resurgence of interest in the quality of tomato and in the biodiversity and in seed saving. This is a current issue of Heirloom Gardener. That big tomato there is a Brianna, by the way. It's one of the varieties we have in our catalog, actually. It's a large, pink-colored, beefsteak, delightful tomato. We'll talk about that. I'm going to go through kind of a tour of heirloom tomatoes, they get back to the last part of the slide, so you can see a lot of photographs and some descriptions of what they're like. But we know that all the modern varieties of tomatoes out there stem from one genus, the Lycopersicum. And the current tomato, which is not the present, but actually current with an A, the small, tiny, berry-like tomatoes are a wild form, a different species, a different genus, as it were. Different species in the same genus of tomatoes. But there are many, many varieties of wild tomato. The wild tomato, by the way, comes not from Florida or California. The origins of tomatoes in the world, of course, were here in the New World. And in particular, it came from the Atacama Desert of northern Peru. So if you keep that fact in mind, it explains a lot about why can't I raise blight-free tomatoes in my backyard? Well, we don't have a desert in our backyard. We have a humid, hot summer environment around here. And that's the enemy of tomatoes, humidity. And so the worse the humidity is, the more blight you're going to have. How many folks here raise tomatoes? How many folks had blight last year in their tomato crops? Yeah, it was the most humid summer I can ever remember. Call that one day last year in July, we had a dew point of 83. Our friend Michael Lynch, the meteorologist down here, that was the highest dew point. It's higher than tropical weather, higher than tropical jungle weather. It was an amazingly humid stretch in the summer last year. Well, humidity and tomato plants don't mix very good. That's why they have trouble in Florida. They have to use so many pesticides to raise crops down there. So, here you go, heirlooms. Why? Well, the wild ancestral tomatoes that gets mentioned already here came from as far as the large tomatoes we grow today, come from a single gene mutation. The tomatoes, although their wild ancestors do originate in northern Peru, were actually cultivated and domesticated by the Maya about 1,000 miles further to the north. The Maya Indians in Guatemala and Central America were the ones who really, identified genetic mutations that became large tomatoes that we call tomatoes today. The stuff you find in the wild is like grape-sized or real small, even smaller than that. They look like, taste like tomatoes, but they're really tiny. Tomatoes contain about 12 chromosomes and 35,000 genes, and this whole genome has been mapped, by the way. Some naturally occurring mutations that have occurred in our relatively short last century time here. The determinate tomato. Determinate versus indeterminate, what's that? Well, indeterminate plants are those that keep growing and growing and growing until they get killed by the frost or whatever the case may be. Determinate plants are those that grow to a certain stage, set a lot of fruit, and that's it. They kind of just, they're done. They have a determinate lifespan, determinate size. And there are a few of those that we do grow in gardens. Roma tomatoes, which is a paste tomato, is a determinate plant. The good thing about that, well, they grow to a certain size, get a lot of fruit ripe at the same time. You can can it up at one time. And that's kind of the end of the story. Most of our tomatoes we have that are heirloom are indeterminate, probably 99%. So this one gene hasn't taken over the market by any means. But certainly for commercial production, you can see the utility. Oxheart type tomatoes, they have a point on the bottom, is a mutation that arose spontaneously about 1925. There are a number of oxhearts that are worth talking about. So the question is, determinate versus not determinate, as far as the future of tomatoes is concerned, there's naturally a lot of interest commercially by Monsanto and other seed producers in tomatoes. Tomato diseases have, of course, prompted the quest to make the tomato that would resist disease. I mean, it'd be certainly economically useful for commercial growers as well as for backyard gardeners. And quite a few genes have been identified that may help resist tomatoes. You'll see, in fact, you have your F1 hybrids. They'll frequently have VFN resistance, verticillium, fusarium, nematode resistance. You find, however, in your own backyard, as we've been experimenting for years with new varieties, we, in fact, at our house, we put about 30 varieties in every year that are totally new to us. We're just going to try them out, see how they do. We'll stack them up against what we grew already from the last 25 years and see what's going to hold up or not. Is the hype right or not? Last year, we had great hope for a tomato called Defiant, which was one of the latest introductions of disease-resistant tomato hybrids, right? Well, that plant was as sick as anything else in our garden, I have to tell you. In our own backyard, it didn't perform that well. And as a tomato, it did not stack up in taste. So when I'm talking about, you got to look at what happens regionally, locally, with your own tomato production to get a good handle on the hype versus the hope versus the reality of what you can do with tomatoes. So, but they are digging for new things. Monsanto, of course, is not my hero. They have done much to not help mankind, from Agent Orange on down to to suing small seed-saving farmers mercilessly, which is a bad story by itself. But do we want Monsanto to give us a patented disease-resistant hybrid? Is that the world really needs? I'm not thinking they do. couple of comments on the web. These are that book up there, Fatal Harvest, is an excellent book if you want to read more about the aspects of agriculture you didn't want to know about. How much pesticides and how commercialized and how, you know, where your food comes from sort of stuff. That's a field of tomatoes there. It's not planted yet, but they see the truck going by and they're fumigating the earth there. Use methyl bromide to kill all the fungus in the soil before they plant tomatoes, a very toxic compound. In fact, in Florida, I'm going to show you a slide here momentarily, but I think these are like $2,000 per acre of pesticides and herbicides, over 20 different chemical products to get a tomato crop in Florida. California is a more logical place to grow tomatoes. In fact, most of our canned tomato products come out of California, which is good because it's a dry area. They can grow tomatoes out there without all those pesticides. Comments from the web here of a question about heirlooms versus Monsanto. These new heirlooms will be patented if Monsanto is involved, which means it will be illegal for you to save the seeds, if indeed they actually produce seeds. And of course, they got these Terminator seeds these days now. You've heard about Terminator genes? You plant the soybean and it grows into a crop, but you can't plant the soybeans that grow from the crop because it has a gene that prevents it from becoming fertile. So it's a sterile offspring. It's an intentional genetic mutation to make that seed a sterile offspring product. So, and if their patented genes get in your heirloom tomato varieties, even by accidental cross-pollination, they can sue you, and they will, and they do, and they have. Not for tomatoes, it hasn't gotten that far in tomatoes yet, but it has for soybean and for canola. It's not a good story, guys. Fatal Harvest, you're talking about some ugly stuff here. If you don't believe me, just Google Percy Schmieser and Rodney Nelson. These are two guys who were sued by Monsanto, little guys, raising 100 acres of soybeans, traditional, not hybridized Monsanto Roundup Ready soybeans, who were taken to court and lost by Monsanto. So anyway, there are regional differences in how you can grow things, and that's what I said previously here about having a log, a book, keeping some notes of your garden, what grows well. We do a running experiment, as I said, not just to see what's going to taste the best, because of many wonderful tasting hybrids that just don't do well here in our area. That would do fabulous in California. So you need to kind of be aware of the differences of your own microclimate, your own backyard. Are you in a low area subject to frost? Are you in an area with high wind? Are you, all these microclimate factors, Minnesota versus, say, Iowa versus California versus Florida. I mentioned humidity and blight. There are several kinds of blight. I won't get too deep into that, but there's some good stuff to read about that. There are things you can do to treat blight, by the way. It's back to chemical stuff, fungicides. One's a bit more of a natural approach, using copper soap. Here in Minnesota, we do need a longer season than we can have. You can't just plant seeds for tomatoes in the garden. You have to have actually a 6 to 8 week head start to get a crop of tomatoes. And so we need to have transplants. This is the book I referred to, Tomato Land by Barry Esterbrook. Barry is an author of Eating Well, or editor of Eating Well magazine. He wrote this book about the Florida tomato industry. It's a part of it's partly an expose of the labor abuses that go on there with the migrant laborers, but it's also a discussion at length about tomatoes as a crop and what they've done genetically to alter them, and it's a big business, $5 billion a year in tomatoes in America. It's pretty enormous. This is the Seed Savers Exchange. Yay, the good guys. Okay, this is in Decorah, Iowa. For all those who are really tomato aficionados like I am, the Labor Day weekend in September every year, typically they have a tomato taste off there. It's a big tomato tasting thing. We do that too at our house. We have a tasting dinner. So it's end of August this year, and we will have about 50 varieties of tomatoes, different heirlooms. People can come and sample, taste them, have a great dinner, and enjoy company of like-minded crazy people. But this Seed Service Exchange here has about 8,000 members, including me. They have a lot of varieties of stuff available in their huge catalog, 4,000 tomato varieties, for example, that are available there. So they're a big non-governmental seed-saving and heirloom perpetuating organization. My hat's off to those guys. There are some quirks about heirlooms. Why would you, you can make critical comments, why would I want to not grow the perfect cosmetically blemish-free tomato that's got bulletproof skin? Well, I can tell you why. I'll accept some of the quirks of heirlooms for their gorgeous flavor, their beauty, their inherent beauty. For example, the shoulders on some types of heirlooms don't ripen. It may be green on the top, but the rest of the fruit's red. Here, a Cherokee purple, good example. Not irregularity. These are irregular-looking tomatoes. Would you buy that in a store? Maybe you'd buy the perfectly round red thing. It looks gorgeous. It's got better color, better look to it. So cosmetically speaking, they are indeterminate mostly, so they're big and lanky, need a big cage to hold them up. They have some disease susceptibility. But I have to say, disease susceptibility across the board varies tremendously in heirlooms. You'll find some that are very tough to diseases. I can point one out right now. Red velvet cherry tomatoes, those plants don't get blight. They just don't. I'll show you a picture of those momentarily. It's got a silver, grayish, kind of pale green looking foliage to it with fuzz all over the leaves. And they're delightful cherry tomatoes, and they just don't get blight. There are other varieties I can point to that are terrible, though. Paul Robeson is a big black tomato. That's a gorgeous tomato in a good year. But in a bad year, your Paul Robesons are going to look like dead meat out there on a dead plant. And it's just, you know, that variability is a lot. You got to understand. And there are ways of getting around that, by the way. We'll talk about some techniques here. But one technique we discovered at our house, put your worst blight-resistant varieties under plastic. If they don't get rained on, they don't get wet, they do a whole lot better. We had some in a hoop house last year that just did tremendously. We had Cherokee purple, which are really tough to grow. In our hoop house, we'd be picking Cherokee purples until they froze out. So they're gorgeous, gorgeous plants. So yields can be less. People argue, well, I grow hybrids because they get more tomatoes per bush. And I'll argue the point. I can tell you about hybrids that are less yielding, and I can tell you about heirlooms that are more yielding than the comparable hybrids. And so Boxcar Willie is one of those varieties. I think if you want to look about yield, if your goal for raising tomatoes in your backyard is to have an enormous amount in the bucket at the end of the year, try Boxcar Willie or Cosmonaut Volkoff. These are heirlooms that really will produce as good as any hybrid. I challenge you to disprove me on that point. We've done it ourselves. We have many years trialed the hybrids of choice. Big boy, big girl, better boy, da-da-da, celebrity. Right next to the plants, like Boxcar Willie, Cosmonaut Volkoff, and the yields were identical, if not better, in the heirlooms. So there are heirlooms that can out-yield, if that's your big goal, to have a lot of tomatoes.
What's the second
one you said? Cosmonaut Volkoff. I got a slide of that one coming up. So yeah, the yield is not a big deal. If you're growing Cherokee purples, I can tell you, you're not going to get very many. Brandywine, which is a marvelous tasting tomato, you're not going to grow it for production. You're not going to grow Brandywines that fill up jars of tomatoes in your basement, okay? You're growing Brandywine to eat them because they're so delicious. And if you've never tried a Brandywine tomato, fresh vine ripened off the plant, you are missing something. Okay. You won't get many. You'll probably get a half a dozen fruit off of one plant. So you plant a couple and you savor the moment when they get ripe. Okay. Tomatoes are good for you. Tomatoes are high in vitamin C, vitamin A, potassium, and a red pigment. The red ones are called lycopene. And lycopene, we know, is an antioxidant. Some factoids here about tomatoes. They contain, if you cook them, you actually can liberate more lycopene, which is actually a kind of little trick. If you cook them and if you have them in some olive oil or oil of any kind, it'll increase the bioavailability by about 50%. Lycopene may reduce prostate cancer risks for men. They're good for the eyes, the pigments that are found in there. Lutein, zeaxanthin, and lycopene all have properties that help prevent macular degeneration in old people. Okay, how to grow incredible heirlooms. Just a real quick rundown here of approaches. Build up your soil organically. Add amendments. We're talking compost, we're talking manure, we're talking about mulch. We use leaves in our garden, the kind you rake up in your yard in the fall. We don't rot them for 5 years. We don't grind them. We do nothing. Just put them right on the plants in the springtime once they can get established. And they sit there and the earthworms do the rest. They become tilth in my soil by the end of the summer for the most part. Rotate your locations if you can, because diseases of tomatoes to some extent can overwinter and stay in certain spots, especially septoria and certain other of the tomato fungal diseases. Others you can't get away from. They come in the wind. So it's not just a matter. You can go to a brand new field, brand new patch of ground, till it up, plant tomatoes, do everything just right, and still get the blight. Because on a hot, humid day when the wind is blowing, it comes right through the wind. So you can't get away, especially late blight is particularly windborne. Mulch them. If you can keep the soil off the leaves, that's a good idea. So when we plant our tomato plants, we put mulch down right away. Tomato goes in, mulch goes on, at least for a couple feet around the plant to start out with. Number four, avoid late afternoon watering. When your plants get wet in the evening or late afternoon, they may stay wet all night. promoting fungal growth on your leaves. You don't want that to happen. If your leaves can stay dry, you'll avoid a lot of blight. That's why the hoop house works, because you don't get any moisture in the leaves. You water the ground, not the plant. Number five, adequate calcium. Blossom end rot, which occurs to certain types of tomatoes more than others, is avoidable by calcium supplementation. The plants need calcium. Good quality organic soil, organic fertilizers that you get in some brands do contain calcium for that very reason. You can add it from different ways. You can certainly add Tums or Rolaids, or we use eggshells. We keep eggshells and crush them up into powder and just throw a little handful in the soil. We're going to plant the plant, just kind of mix it in the soil, and that'll take care of it for the year. We never see, ever see blossom end rot, ever. It doesn't happen. It's not a rot. It's actually a calcium deficiency, and it also can be promoted by moisture fluctuations. So keeping things relatively evenly watered for the first part of the year. Cages, we sell a thing called the Super Cage. It's a lifetime guaranteed bulletproof cage. You see this if you buy in the store, and of course they don't last, they bend, they rust, they fall over. A good cage helps keep things off the ground, obviously. So staking, planting, whatever you want to use is a good idea. Do-it-yourself concrete mesh, get that 6x6 concrete mesh, you can roll it into cylinders, make tomato cages at home yourself. Space them well enough apart. If they're crowded as back-to-back-to-back tomatoes, of course, they're going to get very little air circulation. They'll shade each other. Your production will fall. So about 4 feet apart if you have good tomato plants like we do in our garden. Our tomatoes typically are going to be about 6 to 7 feet tall. And then they get so big they fall over the top of the cage. And you know, and there's, but by the time it's usually the end of the year. And finally, good garden hygiene. In the end of the year, don't just let it sit there. Get those dead plants out of there. Don't put them in your compost pile because they tend to have those diseases on them. Burn them, bag them, get rid of them is probably a good idea. If you have a hot compost pile, yeah, you're fine with that tomato stuff, because it'll, if it gets to a really high, like 180 degrees, that kind of compost pile, it'll take care of a lot of that. Yes?
Exactly, calcium, have you tried ashes from like a wood stove?
Yeah, that's more for potash. Wood ashes from a stove don't have a lot of calcium in them. But they're not a bad thought to add a small amount into the soil, but it does add a lot of acidity as well.
Do you clean your cages every year then?
We do.
With bleach?
Bleach, yeah, bleach solution. Okay, the Heirloom Tomato Cookbook. There are a lot of good cookbooks out there just geared toward the heirloom. Why would they have a heirloom tomato cookbook to start with? Because they're such good tasting tomatoes. They're such worthwhile things to have. So it's really not all about the supermarket, you know, perfect blemish-free tomato. It's all about the taste. Color me delicious. All the colors of heirloom tomatoes are quite amazing. And more heirlooms here. One in the middle top up, there's black cherries, one of our favorite cherry tomatoes. They're just delightful tomatoes. Sun sugar, upper right, incredible. These are addictive things. Did you know that the vine-ripened tomato that you get out of your backyard is actually much better for you? If you look at nutrient content, twice as much of those two antioxidants, quercetin and camphorol. 30% more vitamin C, 30% more thiamine, more calcium, more niacin, and infinitely greater flavor. I mentioned this cooking with oil, good idea. Let's go through the list of tomatoes. We're going to give you about 25 tomatoes and kind of share with you some of those features of them that make them really worth talking about. Yes, sir.
Do I need more than one plant of a type to cross-pollinate, or is that a myth?
No, that's a myth. Tomatoes do not cross-pollinate. The varieties we're talking about are all self-pollinating. You can plant one tomato only.
So if I see 12 varieties, I can have one plant of each of these 12?
Absolutely. Yep, good question. Brandywine. How many folks have heard of Brandywine? I mean, if you're into heirlooms at all, this is kind of the cult tomato. That's what people get when you're talking Brandywine. This came out of Pennsylvania, 1880s time span, Stokes and Johnson catalog originally. Large fruited, not very heavy production, not perfect, won't win any beauty contests. You can see the cracking goes on here, green shoulders on the top again. Irregular scalloped kind of side walls. But yet it's a gorgeous tomato, and so the flavor is unbelievably good. The traditional one is called the Sudeth strain. It's a pink tomato, not really pink, and it's kind of a dark red or light red. This quote here by Barry Estabrook, the author of that book, Tomato Land, he said, there's no better tasting tomato than Brandywine. Well, sweetness and tartness playing off each other perfectly in juices that burst in your mouth in a surge that forces you to abandon all pretext of good manners and slurp. I think I would agree with this. You know, nothing like a Brandywine. Again, you're not going to get a lot of production off this plant. It's moderately blight susceptible. It's not going to be the toughest plant in the garden, but it's not the weakest one either. This one here is my wife's very favorite tomato of the larger ones. It's called Orange Russian 117. It's got a point in the bottom, so it's therefore a oxheart type of tomato. Bicolored, mainly reddish, but with yellow streaking going through it. Some call it, Amy Goldman, the author of that book I showed you earlier on Heirloom Tomatoes, says it's got unparalleled flavor. I would agree it's an excellent quality tomato. It's not my very favorite, but it's certainly right up my top five. It's moderately blight susceptible again, as like a Brandywine. This is a very delightful tomato, Cherokee Purple. Notice the green shoulders here. Again, cracking, irregularity. Cherokee Purple was originated with the Cherokee Indians in Tennessee. The seed was passed along for generations. It is not a very robust plant. It gets blight relatively easily. It does not bear that heavily. It's an ugly tomato that goes, it bruises easily. It doesn't last long. You pick it and eat it. In fact, the trick to Cherokees is to pick them before they're fully ripe. And you don't pull them off the plant because you'll bruise them. They're that bruise susceptible. You gotta cut the stem to get them picked properly. And instead of them on your counter for a couple of days and get fully ripe and put them on your sandwiches, and you'll have a treat, like an unbelievable treat. These probably do better, I think, here in Minnesota in a hoop house because they're very blight susceptible plants. But a gorgeous, wonderful flavor there. It ranks. If you look at tomato tasting contests, it'll typically rate in the top five wherever it's tested. But it's hard to grow. White Beauty. Here's an easy one to grow, actually. White Beauty is a white tomato. It's actually kind of a pale yellow. They're gorgeous, very large, remarkably sweet. They have some of the highest sugar content of the full-size tomatoes you're going to run into. If you didn't know what you're eating, put on a blindfold, stuck this on your sandwich, on your BLT, you'd say, wow, this is an incredible tomato. You look at it, whoa, it's not red though. Well, think outside the box. It's a really good one here. Very robust plant, very productive, highly productive plant. Red Rose, an excellent tomato. The only drawback about this one here is that it tends to be ripening late. Notice how pretty they are. These are actually pretty looking tomatoes. They're very rugged. The plants are blight resistant to a good extent. They yield a lot. They get very big, but they bear late. You won't get fruit off this that are ready to eat until probably September, mid-September or later. So if you get an early frost in September, you may be out of luck this year, one of those kind of things. This is worth talking about, a cherry tomato lemon drop. Lemon drop has won all kinds of accolades from wherever it's been tested at. This is a remarkable cherry tomato, very, very productive, very tough, blight-resistant plants. You'll get a good crop off these things. Sweet, tart flavor with a distinct lemony aftertaste. It's very unique. This won the Mother Earth News Tomato Tasting Contest. It won our contest here at ACME Tomato a few years ago. It also won the Seed Savers Exchange contest as best tasting tomato. So when that many people in that many places that many times are saying this is the best tasting tomato they can find on the plate, it's worth growing. This is not what you're going to get downtown. This is what you're going to have to get somewhere, grow your own seed. Red Velvet, that's the one I talked about already. That's a very blight resistant tomato. They're large cherries is what they are, and they're really delicious. This won our contest, the ACME Tomato 2011, last August contest. 70 people tested 50 tomatoes. This was the winner in taste. Okay, it can't beat cherry tomatoes. If flavor is what you're looking for, cherry tomatoes really capture flavor in an incredible way. But also it's impervious to blight. This plant out there, the silver grayish foliage, got no blight on it. Everything else is sick. Here's this healthy plant bearing tomatoes up to the very end. So I was really impressed with that. Matt's Wild Cherry. How many folks have heard of this one? A few have? Yeah. This is actually a tomato that's been out for quite a few years. It was discovered in the highlands of Mexico as a wild tomato, and it is a wild tomato. These vines grow 7, 8, 9, 10 feet tall. They'll take over your garden. So it's even more than a cage. You almost need to put them on a trellis or something like that. But incredibly productive, incredibly sweet, incredibly rich tomato flavor. Very tiny. These go great in a salad. So we do that, in fact, clip off a bunch, and like grapes practically, pluck them off, throw them in your salad, they're delightful. Black cherry, like wow, this is a great, great tomato for flavor. It's a cherry tomato again, but not bad resistance to blight and very productive plants. They tend to crack easy. And cracking happens, of course, after you get rains. If you get a lot of water all of a sudden, you know, many varieties of tomatoes will, thinner skins are going to crack on you. This is one of those thinner skin things, and just what you got to pay, the price you pay to grow them, I guess. They're also kind of hard to pick because you look at your plant like, where are they at? Because they kind of, they're dark and they sort of blend in with the foliage and you got to look around for them almost, but very much worth growing. Jaune flamme, this is a salad tomato. It's kind of a golf ball size, medium size, small tomato called saladette. Very, very good tomato in our garden. These plants are productive every year. They make consistently good tomatoes every year. Tangy, a little bit of a kick to it, a bit of an acid kick to it. Boxcar Willie, I mentioned this to you before. Boxcar Willie is probably the consummate, why would I want to grow a big boy when I can grow a Boxcar Willie tomato? Because this is a tomato that will really produce a lot of fruits. They're good quality. The fruits look good. They don't crack that easily. The plants are, I'd say, medium to moderately blight resistant. So they'll, even in a bad year, you get a decent crop off the Boxcar Willies. Mariana's Peace is a beefsteak, very large tomato, pink-colored tomato. This is a what some people would have called the world's best-tasting tomato. It kind of ranks up there with Brandywine. It's a very fine-tasting fruit. Now, Mariana's Peace are not very productive if you're trying to get volume. I want to have 59 pounds off my plant. You won't get it off this plant, okay? But you'll get probably by the end of the season maybe 15 to 20 ripe fruit off of it. And that's what you expect to get. And if you're happy with that and can enjoy the quality of that flavor, then you're in business. Moderate production, moderately blight susceptible, potato leafed. Now there's a difference between different types of plants. Have some of the short, sharp, pointy, classic tomato leaves. Others have a potato or rounded, scalloped edge to the leaves. They're called potato leaved. Potato leaved plants, in my observations, tend to be a bit more blight resistant. This is a new cherry tomato to us. It's a green cherry tomato. We love growing cherries because we'll grow different colors. The black cherry, the sun sugar, the green ones, the, you know, all the varieties. In a salad or in a cherry tomato salad, or in, they're wonderful in the kitchen. So colors are great. This is a wonderful tasting green cherry. Brianna, one of my very favorites. We discovered this 2 years ago in Iowa. Brianna's a large beefsteak, pink colored. What I like about it is the rich flavor. In my book, it's up there with Brandywine. It's also a beefsteak that's got character to it. Many of your large tomatoes tend to get mushy. They don't have good consistency. This is one that does. You can grow this to full maturity, you slice it up, and it's got good texture to it. It's not just mush. Pineapple is a bicolor tomato, and we've trialed this one against many, many other bicolors over the years. And the two bicolors that still stand the test of time in our catalog is this one here. And the next one I'm going to show you is Virginia Sweets. This is a very good tasting one. We've grown Hillbilly, and you can name quite a few other varieties of bicolor tomatoes, but this one seems to be a better tomato for production, for flavor. Doesn't crack as much. Here's Virginia Sweets. This is one worth talking about. This is a excellent quality, large beefsteak, bicolored tomato, fabulous flavor, very productive plants. We're talking about, you want production, you get production off this plant. It is very, very productive. Paul Robeson, this is named after a U.S. black operatic singer, orator. His name was borrowed by the Russians, who've developed quite a few black varieties of tomatoes, black from Tula, black Krim, black Russian, Ukrainian purple. Are a lot of names and heirlooms that are black that go back to the Russian bloc countries, if you will. This is one that comes out of Russia as well, and it's a good quality, delightful large beefsteak. That tomato was not grown here in Minnesota, I can tell you that, for because most of the Paul Robesons here are going to be cracked because of heavy rains that hit them. They're also going to be relatively blight prone. On a good year, what would be a good year for tomatoes, by the way? A good year for tomatoes would be a drought year. A drought year with low humidity would be a perfect year for growing tomatoes. Have a great year. You'll get great Paul Robesons, great Cherokee Purples, great all of those kinds that are hard to grow normally. A great tasting tomato, but it is it does require special care or a hoop house or whatever. And Aunt Ruby's German Green. green tomatoes sound like a weird, you know, fried green tomatoes, the movie kind of thing. That's actually a fried unripe tomato, but these are ripe, well, they're ripe when they're green, and they're green when they're ripe, I should say. You can kind of tell they're getting ripe because the bottom gets kind of a blush, a yellowish or a pinkish blush, and the texture changes, so you know they're ripe. But they're wonderful flavored. Most tomatoes have, of course, they're green when they're not ripe. What happens? The chlorophyll at a certain point turns off and you start getting red pigments. You get the red ripening effect. These don't lose their chlorophyll. There's a mutation that causes that to happen. But they're very sweet and extremely good tasting. As has been described by Amy Goodman, sweet, spicy, and scrumptious. Also, if you like to make salsa verde, a green salsa, it'd be a good place to start with that. Kellogg's breakfast. This is a large, really intense orange beefsteak tomato. There are many, many folks who tell me, give me feedback about how they love the flavor of this beefsteak tomato. And I would agree it's an excellent one, a very large, it's a productive plant. I'd say moderate to good blight resistance, and they are late season like some other big tomatoes. The larger the tomato, the later it's going to be ripe in the season. The early tomatoes that we have, that we sell to folks, are Stupicha and Ultimate Opener. Stupicha, I'll show you a slide of that here momentarily, is the winner in my book. I've never seen an earlier, better quality tomato than Stupicha, which is coming up. San Marzano, this is an heirloom out of Italy here. It's a canning tomato. If you go to Buyer Leisure, some fine store, and look for a great can of tomatoes, it's going to be probably San Marzano's. They'll sell you by name San Marzano. As a paste tomato, they don't have a lot of flavor. You would probably want to go out to the garden and grab one and start eating on it. You would or you could, but it's relatively flat. What these tomatoes excel in is their low moisture content, low seed content, and a lot of solids. So if you're canning paste or tomato sauce for the winter, or any kind of tomato product for the winter, you like paste tomatoes. That's why we got about 8 varieties of paste tomatoes in our catalog, because they are for that purpose. You grow them for that reason, you can them, you make sauce, there's pizza sauce, spaghetti sauce, whatever, out of them. They don't crack, they're quite resistant. Polish linguica is one of my favorite paste tomatoes. Why? Because they're big. They're big and they're pasty in the sense they got that solids content. Polish linguica is this tomato right over here, this big one right there. And there are other large-sized so-called paste tomatoes like Amish paste. That's the lower right-hand side there. It's an Amish paste by comparison. There's a Stupicha. Stupicha is from Czechoslovakia, by the way. It's an old tomato. It's an early tomato. It's meant to bear early. These things will set flowers even in colder temperatures. The problem with tomatoes setting fruit is they need temperature. You need nighttime temperatures to stay above 60 degrees. So if you keep getting lows in June that are dipping down into the 50s, many of your flowers will not set their fruit. You say, what's going on? I mean, fruit, it's July. Well, a cold June will do that to you. This one won't do that, though. It sets fruits right off the bat. Even under cold temperatures, it fertilizes its own self and becomes tomatoes. So you'll get first fruits for these here typically about July 10 most years. And they're good tasting. They're small, but you can make spaghetti sauce out of them or use them in sandwiches or salads. They're decent. Nice thing about Stupicha, they keep bearing all summer long. Right up to the very bitter end, you'll get Stupichkas. So I like this tomato as an early one. We've trialed them against, you name a plant, I think we tried it, Glacier, Early Girl, just lists of tomatoes. This one usually wins as far as being the earliest tomato in the garden. Cosmonaut Volkov, what can I say? Named after the famous Russian cosmonaut. This is a wonderful tomato from the Ukraine. It's like Boxcar Willie. It's a main season crop. You just want a plant to put out there, just make a bunch of red tomatoes about that big for tomato for sandwiches. This one or Boxcar Willie are the ones you'd want to consider putting out because they really are very productive, good flavored tomatoes. And the Cosmonaut Volkovs are actually much more handsome, I think, than Boxcars. They're definitely more smoother, slightly larger fruit. different colored tomatoes. We've talked about black and orange and green, and this one here probably is one of the better yellow tomatoes out there. We've got a couple of yellow tomatoes that we love to grow at home. Degma's Perfection is one. I mentioned White Beauty. This is another one, Lillian's Yellow here. A very memorable flavor, disease resistant. We never seen them get rotten. Large sized, low seed count. These are quite meaty for a beefsteak. And finally, Amish paste, as mentioned earlier, is a canning tomato. But this candy tomato has one distinction. There are many, many fans of Amish paste. As a canning tomato, you get a lot of fruit. They're larger size, not as much peeling to do if you're canning. And they do crack, however, and they are not quite as meaty as far as the solids as your other canning tomatoes. Zapotec, this is a variety out of central Mexico. It goes back a long ways. These are tough tomatoes. What's good about these here, you can cut them in half, and there's very little seeds and are hollow inside. You can stuff them. So wherever you see recipes for stuffed tomatoes, this is your tomato right here. It's going to hold up for stuffing. What are we going to try for the coming year? That's on our list this year. We're going to plant out there that are new to us and never tried them before to see how they compare. We will take tomato varieties that in a given category, say a yellow tomato, beefsteak sized, compare them to others that are out there that have promise. And every year we kind of compare. Okay, did they, side by side, planting in the garden, did this yellow beefsteak tomato do better than that yellow beefsteak tomato? That's how we got to our catalog, by trial and error and process of elimination. So some good looking ones up here. I'm going to try to, like a Dr. Weick's yellow, for example, and quite a few scalloped tomatoes from Italy, Costoluto Florentino and Costoluto Genovese. We're going to put them both out in the garden this year for trials. So other ones. Anyway, I'll stop at this point and answer some questions.
Every year I use a permanent marker on a wooden stake to write the name so that I can try to be somewhat scientific. By about August, I can't see a thing. So what do you use to label your plants?
We actually take a little surveyor marker flag,
yes,
and mark on there with a Sharpie,
yeah,
and this wired to the cages. And so it's easy to kind of spot what you got there, and with that you, it doesn't wash off.
Okay.
The marker flags work better than the sticks for us.
Okay.
And Sharpies. I know some gardening catalogs will actually sell you markers. They're supposed to be waterproof and bulletproof, whatever. I don't know how good they are, but I don't need it. A Sharpie does good for me.
Okay. Great.
And you're right about keeping track of things. I'd encourage you to keep a garden log or diary as well, if you don't, from year to year like we do. You'll find me out there every year kind of taking notes all summer. Okay, what's going on blight-wise and production-wise, and how soon are they bearing fruit?
How do you solve the problem of rotation when you have just a small
plot? Yeah, if you've got a small plot, you don't have the luxury of doing a lot of rotation, do you, there? You really don't. I mean, I don't know how big a deal it is, but I'd say probably just be very, very good about cleaning that garden up in the fall of the year. Get everything out of there, and you probably could go a step further if you'd want to. I'm not sure your backyard would allow you to do this, but you can get one of these flamethrower weed killer things, a tank of propane and that weed thrower. Just torch your soil. Just hit the top of the soil before you turn it over. You'll kill all kinds of fungal spores and dead leaf material on the surface of the ground before you till it under. I'd probably go that far if that's all I had to garden on, the flamethrower. Yes?
Would black plastic in the sun do the same thing?
Yeah, black plastic will also give you mulch qualities because it'll keep the moisture in the soil and it will also keep the fungus from splashing up on your plants. The problem with black plastic is it gets quite hot. And
that's what I meant, just put it there and get it really, really hot before you plant.
Oh, I got you. Yes, yes. Not a bad idea. I mean, that would not be a bad idea. Even clear plastic would even do that for you to kill things in your soil. Just give it a month of clear plastic, black plastic, whatever, to kind of hopefully kill things in the soil.
Have you tried the red plastic?
I have, and you see for sale in catalogs that sell tomato things, this red plastic mulch you put down around the bottom of the tomato, increasing the growth of the plant, and because it reflects certain spectrums of light on the leaf bottoms or whatever. It probably works, and I've tried it before. I just wasn't impressed. It made a big difference. So if it's a 10% difference, I couldn't see it. So I don't waste my money on that.
So what do you recommend for wind problems?
Wind problems, yeah, good stakes, yeah. If you got wind problems, no matter what kind of cages or staking you've got, we will, in our garden, I know there's going to be a windstorm at least once a summer where there's going to be 70, 80 mile an hour winds coming out of somewhere with a thunderstorm. It's going to happen. If you've got a big mature plant inside of a cage, what's going to happen to it? It's like a sail. It wants to go over. So I, with my rows of tomatoes on the outer edges of the gardens, of the garden, I will put in T-posts. You buy these things for like a buck a piece at Fleet Farm. So I put my cage around my tomatoes. They stick in the ground. They'll stay firmly there until the plant gets big. I put a T-post along the plant, just wired to the cage. So the outside windbreak side of the garden is going to catch that, it'll keep the wind from blowing everything else all over. Yes, sir.
So the VF diseases, you're saying, if you turn your garden, what's going to affect this year's crop? Are those diseases that you've turned over down into the soil also going, or is it just the stuff on the surface?
Well, most of your stuff's going to be on the surface, the top inch of soil. If you've turned it over, the question of that, get rid of your disease, bury the disease for you. If you plow it, you deeply plow it, it'd probably be just fine because the stuff's going to go deep into the ground. But if you're just rototilling, you're just mixing all things together with a rototiller.
I've tried like packing paper also as a mulch, and additional mulch and certain things too.
Right. Yeah, there's a lot of mulch possibilities out there. I mean, you certainly could use rotted hay, you could use straw, you can use, we use leaves, like I say, because leaves are so available to us. You can go to a commercial, a municipal, I should say, leaf dump, and they got rotted leaves there. You can pick them up by the trailer load in the springtime if you're looking for leaves. Yes, sir?
One of the slides has one that was across with the Rutgers.
Yes, that was Red Rose. It's Rutgers Brandywine Cross.
Well, isn't a Rutgers a hybrid?
No. Rutgers was a standard. It's a New Jersey tomato.
Okay.
And there are some heirlooms, quotes heirlooms, that became, basically started as a cross that became stabilized. If you grow a tomato for 8 years from a cross from something, keeps growing the same type over and over and over again, you know you're not going to revert to a parent type. So the stabilized cross is to be introduced as a new heirloom or as a new, you know, self-pollinating tomato. Has to be in existence for 8 years to be considered that. But there are good examples of that, in fact. The Super 100 cherry tomato is now a stabilized cross. It's no longer a hybrid. So, by the way, just mentioned to you guys, we have the ACME tomato catalogs at our booth downstairs. Come by, pick one up. In there, if you're interested in reading more about diseases, there's about a page and a half about tomato diseases. We could talk a long time about tomato diseases. We don't have time to do that today, but diseases are the problem. And the climate is the problem. And so you try to pick varieties, like I said, that are going to be better for us on typical years, others that are worth just struggling to grow because they're so worth having. So if you have the luxury of having more room in your garden to put more tomato plants out, you know, by all means do so. But be diverse. Get outside the box. It's not that all tomatoes are just a red tomato of a certain size. Heirlooms give us a much greater opportunity to enjoy what's really out there. Yeah, great question. Thank you. Pot, container growing tomatoes. There are a lot of them, in fact, that are kind of bred, as it were, to be meant to be grown into pots, or naturally have a stockier stem and a shorter plant type to them. Determinate tomatoes, for example, like Roma. But we have in our catalog about a half a dozen or so container type tomatoes that are available. Some are hybrids, but some are worth talking about. One is not a hybrid. It's called Czech Bush, like in Czechoslovakia. Czech Bush is an excellent container tomato. Yes?
Do you know anyone who's canning tomatoes, like commercially, that are these types of varieties besides that Italian?
Anybody's canning these kind of, heirloom tomatoes?
Yeah.
I don't know if anybody's selling them commercially to people. I think that heirlooms probably are one of those kind of things you kind of like shiitake, what are those mushrooms in the woods in the spring of the year around here?
Morels,
yeah. You don't tell your friends about where you get morels at, do you? You don't sell them either. The morels are kind of like coveted for things. Heirlooms are kind of a bit like that. I mean, you only get so many of them per year, and you may not have a huge amount to sell. I mean, people are growing them commercially. There's in one of those books I have downstairs in our exhibit there, Amy Gia Gunte, I think you pronounce her last name, raises heirloom tomatoes for gourmet restaurants in California. Well, of course, being California, they can grow tomatoes out there without a problem because you don't get the blight. That's easy to grow all those tomatoes out there. You want to grow good tomatoes, guys? Move to California, okay? But she does, and she does can, and she says her very favorite canning tomato is Paul Robeson, and she roasts them, peels them, and cans them, and it's an incredible, incredible tomato for that purpose. So if I had 10 acres to grow Paul Robesons and a good year to do it in, I could probably sell them for a real mint, I'm thinking.
Is it possible to grow tomatoes
during the winter inside?
The question, growing tomatoes inside, well, you could grow them in Minnesota all winter long. You're limited by a couple of realities. Number one, temperature, of course. Number two, light. We don't have much growing season. Tomatoes need about, this, I didn't mention this, but about eight hours of light a day. So if your garden is half shaded, for example, in your backyard, and say, my tomato plants are always big and tall and lanky and they don't bear much fruit on them, I can tell you why. It's probably no light. And if your tomato plants in your garden plot is next to a bunch of trees, those tree roots will find their way into your garden. They'll be robbing the nutrients in there because they're going to know it's a good place to go for goodies. So you got to be careful where you have your garden at, and if it's in partial shade, you're not going to get as good a crop of tomatoes for sure. They need light. They're light-loving plant. They need full light, ideally. In the house, problem is that windows filter UVB, ultraviolet B wavelengths, so you don't get as much of a absorption of nutrients or light by your plants in the house. So be careful about what you do there. If you grow plants in windows, for example, for starting in the springtime, like I said earlier, they get really tall and spindly. They just don't do very good. They need better light than that. Now, greenhouse glass is a bit different than the kind of glass you got in your window, which has all kinds of, who knows, coatings and stuff on it to keep you from getting sunburned or something. But so it's tough to grow them in the house. If you go in a greenhouse, you're talking about a lot of heat, aren't you? And is it worth all the money and cost of energy to try to grow tomatoes here in the wintertime unless you're doing it commercially to sell at a high price? It's probably tough for the home gardener to raise tomatoes realistically. They don't grow that good under lights. If you have grow lights, they're not intense enough. Tomatoes need much more intensity of light. They're good for the starting of tomatoes, the grow lights are. They're not good to continue. A plant gets really lanky and it's not enough light for it. It needs natural sunlight.
If you start them under grow lights, how many hours a day do you keep that on?
14 hours. 14 hours of light for seedlings. Well, thank you very much.